Who is an intellectual? What is the image of an intellectual? And what is his identity? Want to find out whether your beliefs are based on myth or reality? Get ready to dive right in with me in the pursuit of these and other interesting questions. Before I begin, let me start by giving some basic instructions that will help you throughout the course of this episode. First of all, whenever I say author, I am referring to the author of the book, The Public Intellectual, Between Philosophy and Politics, edited by Arthur M. Melzer, Jerry Weinberger, and M. Richard Zinman. Also, sometimes you may find that some words like an, of, and the might be missing in this version of the episode. So please overlook these errors as they are unintentional. That's all for intro now, so let's get started. The author says that when we think of the term intellectual, picture of Sartre and Camus come to our mind. And when we look at the historical origin, this phenomenon of the intellectual, then the picture of Voltaire and Diderot come to our mind. Similarly, I have to think what comes to my mind when someone utters the word intellectual. For me personally, the term intellectual carries a lot of prestige along with it. That is, when someone calls someone an intellectual, then I tend to look up to that person because I tend to value that person because I associated the term intellectual with someone who possesses intellect, that is great intellectual prowess or power. So when someone says that such and such person is an intellectual, it implies for me that such and such person high level of mental prowess or power, and I tend to value high level of intellectual power in any person, including me. The question why I tend to value this high intellectual power over low intellectual power or medium intellectual power is for another day's discussion. And for me, when I look at the people who exemplify the notion of an intellectual, then the picture of Ayn Rand and that of Buddha come to my mind. The author says that this phenomenon of the intellectual is unique. That is, it is historically unique in the way that it did not exist in ancient or medieval worlds. And the intellectual differs from other species of knowers which we know. And he also asks what conditions gave rise to the modern intellectual, which is a very important question. So what I can grasp from this para is that an intellectual did not exist from time immemorial or since mankind has attained conceptual faculty, but it is an offshoot. It came into existence at a certain period of time, and also he is different from other kinds of knowledge seekers or knowers. The author says that there are knowers who seek knowledge as an end in itself, and there are knowers who seek knowledge as a means to an end. The end can be the welfare of society or anything else. The author also asks what should be the relation of theoretical knowledge to social action, of reason to history. It is my personal opinion that knowledge should always be a means to an end, and the end is human life or the betterment of human life. I also believe that there is a strong correlation between knowledge, that is theoretical knowledge, and social action, that is between reason and its application to history. Next, the author says that the intellectual is typically secular, and because he derives his claims from the exercise of human intellect alone, so he differs from a priest, but in other respects he also resembles a priest. I think what the author says here is true to some extent, because although an intellectual appears to be all secular and full of reason and rationality, once a person sticks to it dogmatically, then he or she will lose touch with reality as he he or she will believe only that which is included within the ideology of a particular cult that he or she follows. Now the author also says that the intellectual differs from a scientist, because here the intellectual deals with human world, a sphere of politics and culture, whereas the scientist is more concerned typically with the physical or natural world. The question that arises from this is that while it is obvious that an intellectual is not a scientist, the question is, can a scientist be an intellectual besides being a scientist? The answer is obviously yes, as there are many people, many scientists who besides being a scientist are also an intellectual. So a scientist can be an intellectual without any formal training to become one, but an intellectual cannot become a scientist without formal training in becoming a scientist. So the question that follows is that is there any formal training or anything like that which is required to become an intellectual, or can anyone become an intellectual? Next, the author says that an intellectual is a generalist and not a particularist or a technicalist or a technical person. He says that he is a person of ideas who loves ideas for their own sake. What concerns me here is that an intellectual is basically a generalist. That is, although he may talk about particular ideas in a particular context, those particular ideas are derived from a wider framework or a general principle. The author says that although he is a lover of ideas, he is not a scholar or academic, because practical applications of his ideas and the welfare of society is of utmost importance to him. What I recall or remember here is that philosophers have hitherto interpreted the world. The point is to change it, which is a quotation by Marx. The author then says that he is not an intellectual statesman like Cicero or even Plato's philosopher King, because there is an attitude of detachment and he regards political involvement as corrupting his very nature as an intellectual. What I observe here is that although he desires political change or change in politics, he does not involve in it directly like a statesman would do, but he involves in it indirectly through the influence of ideas or by making use of ideas that ultimately fuel a revolution. The next point which the author states is quite important, which is regarding the image and identity, the intellectual. The author says that being an outsider and a misfit, quote unquote, is an essential part of his identity and self-understanding. What I see here is that an intellectual is not a person who goes along with the tide, but goes against the tide. He stands alone, if need be. And he is not someone who agrees for everything, but even questions the standard conventional practices of the society. Next, the author says that there is a contradiction involved in the very concept or fabric of an intellectual, which is to say that he is attached as well as detached at the same time. Like I said before, he is attached to society because he desires social change, and he is detached because he does not involve in politics directly. To a person who does not observe correctly, it seems to me that an intellectual will seem to be a person who is attached to theory but he is detached from practice. But whether it is so has to be questioned. The author also asks the question whether the intellectual embraces the world of ideas in order to help society or to escape it, quote unquote. And he answers that he necessarily claims both things, that is, he wants to help society and also to escape it. I think what the intellectual is counting on here is the power of the ideas to influence action in society. Or in other words, the causal relationship between thinking and action in volitional beings, man. I think what the intellectual is counting on is the idea that if we take care of thinking or ideas, then the action or practice will take care of itself. So if we or place the right ideas, then the right action will follow. In other words, it refers to the idea of Socrates, who says that if someone knows what is right, then he will do what is right. And if he does not do what is right, then he means that then it means that he does not know what is right. I think this relationship between knowing and doing is taken for granted by the intellectual.